I think I've got the microphone here, so maybe I'll start. All very fascinating presentations and some wonderful technologies going on there. But I think for me, there is a problem. That is that when we talk about translation, it means different things to different people, but the key element of translation to me is very much moving from preclinical into man, into early clinical studies. And I'm not sure, having listened to the presentations, that any of those technologies necessarily are going to give you increased information about whether the drug is going to hit the target, it's going to get the target at the right level, and at that level it's going to have some sort of pharmacological effect. And perhaps I'd just like to ask the panel whether they think their technologies can do that, and if not, which technologies they think might be suitable to consider.
Mike, why don't you start, and then we go over and...
Well, I'm just trying to digest the question, but I think the evidence that there is at the moment is that knowing, if I take the example of the cancer, that knowing the constitution, the genetic constitution of a cancer will give you an indication of whether a drug is going to be effective in that cancer. It's going to give you an indication of how effective a drug is going to be. That's all that I was proposing. So it was all about selecting from a pre-existing set of drugs and getting the right choice for the individual patient. And it's about using, it's about moving medicine into a world where all the information that you have can be used, can be aggregated, and can be applied to the needs of that individual patient. And there are clearly many examples already where having some information, nothing like as much as we could get in future, is influencing that choice. So I can't see why it shouldn't get better with more information. How much better? That's the uncertainty.
I think I'm struggling, like Mike, with your question. As far as I'm concerned, I feel much happier that I can start to target cohorts. So the size of the clinical trial, the efficacy in the clinical trial, and the speed with which I can complete the clinical trial, I expect to be much greater than anything I've experienced in the past. And I've done a number of cancer compounds in my career. And, you know, you just chuck an interesting molecule at a cancer, you don't know what's going to happen. And now we start to really define the cohorts. Let's move across to Nick Thomas. Nick, what about your work? I mean, are you going to be aiding translation?
I think translation, because I've talked about two areas, obviously translation does mean many things, different things. I'll give you one example. We and others have been talking with the FDA for the past year, because the FDA recognized the potential of stem cells in drug discovery. And what they're interested in is how does that enable drug companies, biotechs at whatever stage, and up to the stage of generating regulatory filing data, which the FDA are going to look at, how does the advent of stem cells and that kind of holistic surveillance that I described impact on the way people submit information to the FDA? And the reason for that is, as many of you will know, some time ago the FDA brought in virtually the mandatory Hurg test. And what they've recognized is that they've gone too far. So basically in drug development, anything that has a sniff of activity against Hurg is killed immediately, pretty well immediately. So medicinal chemists will try and defend it, but the upper management within pharma, being very risk averse, they'll kill it. So the FDA have recognized that there are a lot of potentially good drugs which are not getting to the patients that need them because they have been too prescriptive. So what they're interested in is the ability of stem cells to give an integrated, and that by integrated can be used in two forms. So if you think about electrophysiology, all the focus has been on looking at drugs hitting individual ion channels, which is fine because you can ask, does it hit A, does it hit B, does it hit C? And you can answer no to all of those, but you don't know about D, E, F, G, and H because you never looked at them. In an integrated system like those cardiomyocytes, they're all there. You can put your drug on, You can look at field potential duration by MEA, action potential duration by patch. If you see something, you'll see it. You're asking all the questions simultaneously. And that's for the 25 compounds that hit EFIS. The other 75 use the other methods, but the important thing is you're doing it in an integrated way using a common model. And that's the game changer, really. Because right now, all the tests are done using different model systems, animal cell lines, ex vivo tissues, which gives a huge problem in trying to integrate that data, either early in drug development or when that data is submitted to the FDA. So in terms of translating and improving the ways, you know, just looking at that one aspect of how drugs translate through the approval process, using stem cells and those types of technology to get better information is going to smooth that process. And hopefully then that feeds back into the pharma and biotech industries, who become less risk averse because everybody understands that you're actually making decisions based on better and higher levels of information.
I suppose generally I would say that, I mean, I've spent years with the challenge of the Anti-Vivisection League. I had 360 protesters on a site one day. I had 22 power bombs on 22 vet sites one morning. It's a tough thing to manage. Cardiac myocytes and stem cells for me say there's a real hope that we can minimize the use of animals. And it also says to me very clearly that we should be able to move the authorities along in terms of the way in which we can embrace biomarkers and physiological change rather than endpoints which we tend to look for today. So we may be able to get a better economy into our translation engine so that we don't limit the technology because of the sheer cost and the period of time to get the product to market. In the middle there, can we have some more hands up for other questions? Another one there, thank you. Thank you.
My name's Eddie Blair from Integrated Medicines. Another well-known quote is, "Those who forget history are doomed to repeat it." And I was listening to Susan Galbraith and Mike and Laurence, I was reminded of pharmaceutical drug development about 20 to 25 years ago in HIV and AIDS. And there you had pharmaceutical companies working together pre-competitively. You had structural biology guiding,
at the core,
you know, identification of new drugs overcoming drug resistance. And you had genomic information guiding the appropriate treatment for patients. So I guess, so there are some lessons in scientific history there in that therapy area. So my question to the panel is, within living scientific memory, which lessons of history would you choose to repeat and which ones would you choose to avoid?
I would pick up, the MRC AIDS directed program was an extraordinary thing. I mean, it was a sort of top-down statement that we are going to do something about this disease. Here is some money. You will all get in a room and play together. And it worked. We delivered drugs. We delivered the reverse transcriptase inhibitors, delivered the protease inhibitors, an entirely structurally motivated and structurally led activity. And these drugs have saved millions and millions of lives. It can be done, but it did require a lot of cultural change on both sides. I was a very, very young researcher, got roped up in that, and I do remember being sat in conversations where I was so far out of my depth in the hierarchy, I had no idea what I was doing there, with major drug company figures who were really, really very, very concerned about getting involved with HIV at all. They were deeply worried that, you know, they had large pockets, and if something went wrong, if people in their companies became infected during the course of the research, they would be in incredible difficulties. And the MRC sort of sponged all of this down, poured huge amounts of oil on the troubled waters, and got the Pfizers and the Wellcomes and the Roches and the Mercks to talk to each other. I just realised that half of those companies don't exist anymore. To talk to each other, and they delivered, you know, they delivered transformative medicine. And it was very, very not risk-averse. I mean, everything was on the table. Any slightly wacky idea that you might have that could come at this virus from a direction that nobody had thought of before would be looked at with compassion and sympathy, and a large amount of very, very excellent science got done. It would be terrible to have to pay the price of a new viral pandemic in order to get that kind of collaboration going again, but it was an extraordinary time, and if one could bring that sort of collaborative and scientific history back into cancer and into other major diseases, some of the major infectious diseases like tuberculosis, I think that level of collaboration is trying to exert itself. But I think that's a lesson from history that I would certainly use again.
Mike?
I suppose it speaks a little bit to where I finished up when I spoke, which is that if we're going to achieve the benefits by aggregation of large amounts of data and their analysis, this is going to be something that's going to require huge, aggressive direction and motivation and drive and a lot of money. This is not something that is going to just happen. And I think that's one of the mistakes that often gets made, that if there are patients in the NHS and there are genomes being sequenced, that means that we're going to get this database of information which is going to yield knowledge. And I don't think that's going to happen unless we have the drive. In my experience of trying to get large-scale initiatives underway, there have not been that many. Not all the sources of funding in the UK have always been very sympathetic to the ideas. The Wellcome Trust has always been the place where I've come to and which has been sympathetic. If we look at the sort of thing I was discussing, this is possibly larger than any single organisation, a charitable organisation, can take on. So it's a lot of words to say that I think we need to be considering new models, new business models for the sort of thing I was describing, to put away all our preconceptions about the old ones, to work out a way of making that happen.
Well done. Nick, either the two of you like to contribute?
Well, I just have a short point. I mean, that monogram up there is probably not it isn't as well known on this side of the Atlantic as it is on the other side of the Atlantic. But one of the things that I guess I've been most happy about in my career in the past 4 years is the fact that a very large multinational US-based company, which probably would be perceived as outside as being quite conservative, took the decision to get into stem cells. And that was, for a lot of other companies, and there are still large pharma companies that will not touch stem cells for various reasons, which we won't go into. But I think, taking that risk, taking that bet on something that you believe in and you can see the future of, in large organizations as well as in small ones, is important. And to have those large organizations work together with smaller organizations, as we do, that's the way things are going to move quickly.
Thanks for that, Nick. I think Connecting for Health was a disaster. I mean, I think we've probably spent £6 or £7 billion in the UK to take individual data and make it available for big data sets in the UK. That was an abortive program. It was done because there was absolutely no trust between the public and the private sector. So IBM wanted to do it. They designed the system. Their chairman said he'd never work with the Department of Health again. Then you saw three other companies come in. They lost, these are respectable companies, they lost $200 to $300 million each. And it was because there was no trust. You had one of the biggest IT challenges ever undertaken, and a great opportunity in terms of looking at individual data, aggregating it, and seeing what came through from big data sets. but the mechanism of partnership, there was none. It was very prescriptive contracting. And if you broke the contract, you didn't meet the standard, you were penalized. So I forget the name of the Japanese company. There was a $250 million write-off. And we actually got nothing out of Connecting for Health. So as we go into big enterprise between the public and private sector, where there are necessary partnerships, there has to be trust. There has to be a degree of transparency on an opening on costs. You're on a joint journey. You cannot have these tight contracts which blow up. And there was no consultation with the medical community on the way in. And there was a doctrine of strict compliance on contracting, for which the taxpayer in the United Kingdom lost, I think, more than £6 billion. I think it's more like £10 billion. And for which everyone in this room lost because we didn't get the advantage of big data set aggregation. That's a very good question. Anyone got something else for us before lunch? Sir?
I'm Jeff Lawton, and I'm interested in Laurence's point about the impact of people on the translation process. In particular, we can all see the emigration of people from pharmaceutical companies into the other areas of biopharma space, including the funders. Clearly, many people in the audience would agree with Laurence that they're bringing some contamination with them in terms of risk averseness into those systems. Do the panel have insights into how we can best transfer the knowledge while leaving some of the cultural baggage behind?
Well, Laurence, you give your quick answer to that, and we'll see whether anyone else wishes to add.
I think it is a challenge. I think the trick is to keep... There's a re-education process, I think, has to go on, and I've been involved in a couple of initiatives in various places where we've deliberately, of course, gone out to try and recruit people out of industry because they have this fantastic skill set and really understand project management. Academics do not understand project management. It's not, by and large, something we are taught. The idea of pipelines, the idea of really running a portfolio of projects is quite alien to most academics. Structural biologists are probably one of the best equipped in that context because we are often working in very parallel ways. But there's a re-education process, I think, on both sides. The academics really have to learn the idea of project management, really have to learn the idea of, you know, if you're going to develop a drug, it is a product. This is a product, and you have to think about it in this quasi-commercial, quasi-industrial way. But I think the other learning that then has to be, and I've occasionally seen this light bulb come on in colleagues that have come out of industry, is you can take chances. You can do something that fails, and that's fine. You'll write it up and publish a paper, and that's a perfectly reasonable way to go. And that, you know, the not being seen to have been the person that proposed the thing that failed syndrome, which seems to be very, very common in industry, is something you don't need to have. And I think it's an educational process. I think also there are organisational ways of doing this that are right and those that are wrong. There's at least one major academic drug discovery outfit that was set up with great fanfare and a large amount of money that was closed after 5 years because it just did not deliver, because it was never allowed to deliver. It was set up in some sort of hermetically sealed, not properly integrated into the academic sense, the idea that you could graft industry onto the side of academia and make it work. There are others where the people largely coming from industry have been absolutely fully intercalated into the academic structure that are working fine. So I think there's learning on both sides, but also, you know, it's getting the synapse between the industrial and the academic right. And I think that's the challenge. I think the big funders can actually benefit us in this by making this something more, putting this kind of interface into what they require in the funding applications, really showing how the drug discovery drive, for example, is going to integrate properly with the academic aims of the institution. But that's something for Bill's trust to drive, I suspect.
it's always a balance, and you know, the industry is much less confident as to its power of innovation with the model of the last 30 years because of the drop in productivity. We need great chemistry and great biology, and we need great process to make this thing happen. And you've got to integrate the two. And you know, I, having been exposed briefly to where GSK is today, led by Patrick Vallance, who's been in academia and industry, and to see how he is devolving the power of decision to small groups as against working up the functional silos, to me that's a better model, which is likely to succeed than the decision being made by the R&D director on every functional speciality. And it also makes it manageable. So, and thank you, Laurence, for talking about the strengths of what comes from industry, and we've got to find the right way of blending the two. But there has been a time, maybe 15 years ago, where the industry was at a stage of arrogance that they felt they could do everything. And I think that we're seeing now, and you could say that AZ moving back onto the Attenbrooks campus is another example of people saying we can't do everything. It's a key partnership. And what we've got to make sure is that we can make those partnerships grow in a very successful way in the UK. Mike, do you want to come in?
Yeah, no, actually.
That's fine. We've got time for two more questions. Any other questions? One in the middle there, please.
I worked at Biomed Central for a while, which does open access publishing. And I wondered whether the challenge of sharing data can be solved by the web and by creating software and standards that allow for the data sets to be put in a standardized format.
To some extent, you may well know that there is the beginnings of a so-called global alliance to doing precisely this, that there is a worry that in the next, well, the next 10 years is going to harbour orders of magnitude more data than we've generated in the last 10 years, and that we have been alerted to the problems of generating data in different formats with different standards in different places, that bringing it together is problematic. So there is this beginnings of an alliance, which is to try and set those standards and in other ways improve the interoperability of the data. And I think that is one thing that will be very important. What part of my message is that won't be enough. That's a way of making what data is available, wherever it is, more or less aggregatable. That doesn't give it that extra level of organization, which allows it to be analyzed to generate the knowledge. And to do that, we're going to have to invest quite a lot as well.
Last question, any more? One on the right side, please.
Hello, I'm Abel Ureta from Eagle Genomics. I have a question about, you mentioned the disaster of Connecting Health and the fact there was no trust. So last week, a new government organization was set up, Genomics England. That's going to be, I understand, organizing the 100,000 genome sequencing. And one of the tasks they will have to have is organizing the IT, the data management, the integration. So how do you see this organization and the way forward implementation to be different for what it was for Connecting Health to be successful?
No, I'm not Genomics England, and at the moment, we just don't know. Genomics England has just been set up. It is exploring the ways in which should be generating the data using the government's £100 million, how it should be storing it, and one hopes it will be learning whatever lessons there were to be learned from the Connecting for Health. But at this stage, it's just too early to tell what direction they're going.
Very good. Well, I'd just like you to join with me and thank our speakers, A, for their professionalism.